साटा हम,
हम देखेंगे
है साटा हम,
अंजादे
है साटा हम,
हम देखेंगे
है साटा हम,
नी अंजादे
मेहनत दा है दावा हम गाते हाँ जान दे सब अपने
कीर्ति कीमत जानन गे
जीवादी सोचा वाले
है साडा है साडा है साडा है साडा
मैदान च पुत्री लुकाई
It's my privilege and honor to welcome the representatives of various members of the opposition political parties participating in this session, which is the last session of the Special Kisan Sabha Janta Parliament held between the 19th to the 21st of December 2020. The other sessions were held earlier. This session, which welcomes the opposition political parties, is being held as a special session. Civil society came together to organize a special Kisan session of the Janta Parliament from the 19th to the 21st of December in solidarity with the ongoing, extremely invigorating, enthusing, and positive assertion of the historic farmer protests. Today's session is to hear the views of the political parties on the resolutions passed by the special Kisan session. It is being organized like a question hour, and there are more some specific questions to which we would like to hear the response of the political representatives. In the interest of time, we request speakers to be brief. I once again welcome all of you to this, to another historic session of the Janata Parliament, and an extremely important session. I hand over the proceedings to Sainath.
Thank you very much, Aruna, and once again, everybody, please welcome to this very special session of the Janata Parliament. I would very quickly go, I would first put out the four questions that I think every speaker, every representative of the political parties should address themselves to. And those are: one, the process by which the three farm laws were passed in Parliament. Should there be a special session of Parliament to discuss the agrarian crisis and steps towards correcting it, including repeal of the farm laws? Two, do you agree that the farm laws should be repealed? Three, what measures should the central government and state governments take towards guaranteeing minimum support price of agricultural produce? And four, what are the other measures that should be taken to alleviate the situation of the farmers in the long and short run? Now, the background to this, those are the four questions, and I'm afraid I might in between be butting in to say, but do answer this question or do address this one. The background to this: in the last session of the Janata Parliament that Aruna mentioned, there were many resolutions in each session. I'm going to sum up for you some of the things, especially from the final session, the outcomes. One was a call for the repeal of the three farm laws, which are unconstitutional. Two, a call for a special session of Parliament to discuss the agrarian crisis and related issues. Not a token 3-day or a 5-day session, a full session of Parliament. Three, the need to organize public action at district. Well, you know, when a government of the day cancels the actual winter session, I mean, and is not interested, there is also the need for the organized public action at district, taluka level, cities, urban areas, panchayats, to bring on boycotts of the corporates harming farmers and of government, and against government policies privatizing, in fact, corporatizing agriculture and privatizing public resources like water, which is, by the way, well underway. Look, and also local issues that will mobilize people to support the ongoing dharnas in support of the farmers protesting at the gates of Delhi. For developing a new consciousness towards the spread of agroecology, the issues of minimum support price as a legal guarantee, decentralized procurement, a universal PDS, encouragement and revival of millets, local markets and small traders to be protected. Also, by the way, to protect also in the long run, an equitable distribution of land ownership and control, especially of marginalized sections of society. Also, there was a call from this Janata Parliament to protect democratic rights related to freedom of speech and expression, life and liberty. Plus, session after session took note of the larger canvas and the immediate issues, including hunger, which went up appreciably under the lockdown. In fact, we had a ridiculous situation in August where you had a population that had not been more hungry in half a century, and 104 million tons piled up as buffer stock. Also taking note and calling for the withdrawal of and opposition to some of the most ridiculous laws and ordinances brought on, like the cattle protection law, so-called protection law in Karnataka, for instance, those kind of cattle protection laws that have sprung up in several states, to oppose also conversion of agricultural land into a commodity to be bought and sold on the market, to look at the issues and absolutely sort out the issue of agricultural credit, which for the last 20 years has seen a diversion of credit from agriculturist to agribusiness. No less worrisome is the entire process of passing those four labor codes in parliament, which was as undemocratic, unfair, and unjust as the three farm laws. The parliament, the Janta Parliament, also took very serious note of the onslaught on the public sector, the kind of new education, the national education policy, the kind of laws coming up around the love jihad, and many more things. But primarily today, I guess what we are asking, since we have the privilege of having the representatives of political parties here, before I just talk about that question once again, I want to go back to November 29th, 2018, where between 1 lakh and 2 lakh farmers from 22 states and 4 union territories, not just Punjab or Haryana, made many of the demands that the farmers at Delhi's gates are making. And on that occasion, 21 political parties came onto the platform of the farmers movement of that time. 21 political parties came on and expressed support. Their explicit, I mean, it was a public meeting where they said that, you know, yes, they were for the special session of parliament, that there we would discuss the National Commission for Farmers report, which has lain 15 years in parliament without any discussion. That many of the kind of issues that are coming up today and which you will be facing today, these 21 political parties declared their support, and some of the top leaders of the political parties were up there on that platform declaring support. Now, with the passage of more than 2 years, I think I would ask each of the speakers to address those questions. Where are you for the repeal of the farm laws? What do you think? Would you address the process by which those laws were passed in parliament? Do you agree still that there is to be a special session of parliament to discuss the agrarian crisis and related issues? What measures should the central government and state governments take towards guaranteeing minimum support price of agricultural produce and the procurement processes that go with it? And what are the other measures you believe that should be taken to alleviate the situation of the farmers in the long and short run? I think that the speakers are already there, I hope. And I wonder if Mr. Raju is connected, and may I call him? Mr. Raju of the Indian National Congress, may I call upon him to speak, please? We'd like all speakers to restrict themselves to within 10 minutes, please.
Okay. Good morning to all of you. I will just take 3-4 minutes, and I would like Raju Gowda to supplement to what I have said. I'll stick to these 4 questions. The process that was formed, that was followed to bring out these legislations, is something that we very strongly object to, Congress Party objected to this process at various forums. In fact, our leader Rahulji led a famous agitation tractors rally in Punjab and Haryana, where he focused his criticism on the process by which these laws were brought. The states were not consulted, farmer unions were not consulted, nor any meaningful discussion had happened in the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha. So the Congress Party has been opposing the process which the present government has followed to bring these laws. Now, to repeal these laws, we strongly advocate that there shall be a special session as why these laws have to be repealed. And I would like to highlight the Congress Party's viewpoint. Just repealing these laws is not going to change the situation of the farmers. There is a need for looking at comprehensively the issues concerning the farmers. So the special session, apart from making out a case for repealing these three farm laws, need to look at various aspects of the farmers, their pain, their issues, the challenges, and have a thorough discussion and come to some agreement on what is the way forward for the farmers in terms of policies, legislations, and programs. So the special session should look at the case for repealing the laws and also have a comprehensive discussion on the issues concerning the farmers. The second issue, I think we are for a legislative framework for the MSP. Congress Party has been supporting this MSP, and there has been efforts to really expand the MSP coverage among other states beyond Punjab, Haryana, through decentralized procurement. And having seen the current situation, we are firmly of the view that time has come for the government to come up with a legislation on the MSP to include those crops which we need to keep in mind, keeping in view the food security, because the latest survey reports bring out very clearly the country is facing food security, nutrition security. Time has come for us to really look at that and design our the MSP cover, the kind of crops we need to include under the MSP. So there is a need for a legislative support for the MSP. Now, coming to the other measures, I'll just take 1 or 2 minutes. Congress Party is advocating a vision for the agriculture resting on 3 pillars. Number one, the farmers deserve a regulated market, because there are lakhs of farmers producing, lakhs of producers, lakhs of traders. So you can't expect the farmers to deal with the market, which is going to be dominated by 1 or 2 corporates, crony capitals. Government has a moral responsibility to put in place a regulated market. Government has to invest on the regulated markets by way of promoting institutions where farmers have a role in managing those regulated markets, and also invest on the infrastructure in mandis, infrastructure in weighment, infrastructure in storage, all such things. It is the primary responsibility of the government to commit to expanding the regulated markets and investing in making those markets work for the farmers. That is number one pillar. Second pillar is, just the regulated markets are not going to help the farmers. Whole lot of support to the farmers government has to commit, whether it is subsidized in inputs, whether it is providing much deeper access to credit, whether it is providing access to the science and technology. All these things, investment in the farmers is something that government has to commit. Thirdly, the food security paradigm that the country has built over a period of time, that needs to be protected. It needs to be in fact made more universal, expanded. So the procurement responsibility of the government needs to be re-emphasized. So these are the three pillars on which the Congress Party is articulating its vision for the farmers. Thank you very much. Now I would like to request
Raju Garu to add. Raju Garu, I just have a question, which is, when you ask for the legal guarantee on the MSP, would you include guaranteed procurement in that legal guarantee?
Yes. Without guaranteed procurement, the legal guarantee of MSP will be only on the paper.
Yeah.
So we are very clear on that. The legal guarantee of MSP would essentially include legal guarantee of procurement of XYZ commodities. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Gowda of the Indian National Congress. Would you please present your views?
Sure. So Rajuji has already laid out the central agendas that the Congress has, and all of us were involved in the manifesto of the Congress, which in recent times has been misinterpreted by the BJP, saying, oh, you also favored dismantling of some of these systems. The basic point is that whatever changes that we have proposed are holistic. You can't just do, dismantle one aspect and then expect that everything else will fall into place. And one of the key learnings that we've seen from the last few months has been that there was a reason why this was a state subject, because the complexities of agriculture are very regional, and they required not a one-size-fits-all solution, but tailored solutions in different niches. Now, the agitation is spearheaded by the early Green Revolution states, partly because they're the ones who can very, very clearly see that this is going to dismantle everything that has allowed them to basically run agriculture in a reasonably successful manner. But in the rest of the country, there are numerous problems, and there are numerous unanticipated consequences of these changes. For example, this whole notion of if you open up markets in the with the idea that you're actually going to prevent exploitation by middlemen, what is the alternative that you're providing? Are you providing organizational support to farmers through farmer producer organizations or cooperatives or anything like that, which will actually strengthen their hand and bargaining power? What happens if you do not do that and you do a piecemeal change of this sort? What you are seeing is a government hurtling towards these kinds of signaling-oriented laws, but which also have a deeper reorganization of the economy in favor of what looks like the favorite industrialists of the present government, right? And and therefore, it's actually this requires all the arguments that even they're submitting to the Supreme Court, saying this has been studied for 10, 15 years. This has been studied by different commissions, but has not been studied adequately. And we absolutely need additional studies and scenario planning and exploration to understand what would happen in each of these contexts. And that's why it's absolutely imperative that we not just have a special detailed session of parliament. What we had proposed in the Congress manifesto, we actually need a separate Kisan budget. We actually need commissions on agricultural on agricultural issues, which revisit these issues in the context of the changing market dynamics that have emerged. But otherwise, what Rajuji pointed out, the crucial need for investment in the entire chain and infrastructure, all of those, I absolutely support. And, I'm not in parliament anymore, but I was appalled to see how it was rushed through. This has been the pattern of this government. Either they will try and ambush the opposition by bringing in, laws without any adequate notice for us to prepare. I also head the Congress Research Department. It's my job to actually ensure that my colleagues are well prepared. And when you suddenly, announce with 5 minutes notice that this is what you're pushing through, like they did with Jammu and Kashmir, we are really faced with a challenge on how to do these things. The process that was followed was a sham, and I joined Rajuji in fully supporting the resolution demands that we need a special session, we need to repeal these laws, we need to revisit this issue in much more detail. Thanks.
I have a couple of questions for both Mr. Gowda and Raju Garu as well. And that is, you see, you have declared yourself at the party's, your party's position on the repeal of these laws, on the holding of a special session of parliament, on greater public investment in agriculture. Now, I would like you to say something on, when you speak of a new vision for agriculture, Raju Garu, or resting on three pillars, and what is your position currently on the Congress Party on the National Commission of Farmers reports? The first report was submitted to Parliament in 2004 December, when the UPA was in power. The last report of that, the fifth report, and the second volume of the fifth report, followed by a draft national policy on farmers, was submitted by October 2006, when the UPA was still in power. Now, if there was anything approaching a national blueprint on agriculture, whether one agrees with it totally or not, it was this National Commission of Farmers report, popularly known as the Swaminathan Commission or Swaminathan Report. Indeed, if there are two English words that farmers across the country, from Bengal to Maharashtra and Kashmir to Kanyakumari, if they know two words, they know Swaminathan Report, right? And there is enormous trust in that report from the farmers. That was the theme also in 2018, when the Congress and other parties were part of that activity in November 29th. Now, what is, the reason for the trust was also that those reports were based on years of work and the widest possible consultation of farmers, farmers' unions, not just think tanks in Delhi. So I would like to know where you stand in that special session. Do you see the need to at long last discuss those reports, discuss the direction and way forward they've given? They've covered not just MSP and procurement, but about climate resilience, about agroecological approaches to agriculture. I'd really like both of you to comment on.
I think the Congress Party, though the recommendations of Swaminathan Commission was not acted on recommendation by recommendation, but the party has really responded to the basic message that was coming from the Swaminathan Commission's report. In fact, Professor Swaminathan was a member of the National Advisory Council. I was also part of that council, and I've seen a number of occasions where these issues have come up for discussion, and the party has taken a myriad of actions following those recommendations, such as a farm loan waiver, bringing Land Acquisition Act, and also bringing National Food Security Act. So some of those recommendations were acted upon, but I would agree that recommendation by recommendation, discussion, consultation, and formulating a position has not happened. I'm sure the party, looking at the current farm distress, should be prepared to take up that kind of a discussion and formulate a view on those recommendations. So we are positive at revisiting those recommendations. Thank you.
Mr. Gowda?
Rajuji was present throughout that period with the National Advisory Council, and I was a professor at IIM at that time. But so I think he has a better sense of what happened in the policymaking circles and the party's position. We are firmly committed to, for example, the formula that Swaminathan has proposed, the report has proposed, which takes into account the full range of input costs rather than what the government keeps touting as having respond, what they have come up with in terms of response. The other point I want to mention, I do agree, there is this could have been fast-tracked in a much more advanced, much more intense manner than has happened. But going forward, if you think about one of the central mindsets in this is the requirement that we cannot leave the farm sector to market forces alone, that we have to think about subsidy regimes, we have to think about basically we don't have to be exceptional in the world when it comes to looking at farmers in rural distress. We don't have to say we're going to open up everything without a safety net. And when we look at every other country, that's exactly how, because agriculture is not a sector that can actually survive. And given the population that depends on agriculture in our country, given the fact that there's a certain feminization that is also picking up, and a lot of women and their concerns are not yet being considered adequately, there is a lot that the government has to do in terms of both the soft and hard infrastructure and the subsidy regimes as we go forward.
Thank you so much. May I now call on Mr. Sukendu Shekhar Roy of the Trinamool Congress to present his party's position on those questions and anything else he wishes to add. Sir, please.
Good morning, everybody. Good
morning.
Can you hear me?
Very clearly.
Should I speak in English or Hindi?
Up to
or
you.
Or both?
Maybe both. Up to you, sir.
Okay. The 3-4 questions that have been put to us by this Jan Sansar. First of all, I welcome them on behalf of All India Trinamool Congress and our leader, Ms. Mamata Banerjee, who has extended her compliments to all of you for coming out at this stage when the country is suffering from unprecedented terror. And it is a state-sponsored terror in all walks of life. So, coming back to the subject, my distinguished friend Mr. Gowda. Mr. Gowda has already explained in details. I did not repeat. But my feeling was that when the bill came to Parliament, as if the Rajya Sabha, the upper house, was reduced to a Pathshala. When you studied in the Pathshala, the teacher had a chhadi in his hand, and we used to chant whatever he said with the movement of that chhadi. So, संसद में भी ऐसा एक माहौल पैदा किया कि कंठरोध कितना दूर हो सकता है कि अपर हाउस तक इस तरह पहुंच गया, जैसे कि गोड़ा जी ने बताया कि 5 मिनट के अंदर सब कुछ हो गया, चलो छुट्टी, और छुट्टी किसका हुआ, हमारा अन्नदाता का छुट्टी। इतना बड़ा महत्वपूर्ण कानून वो बनाना चाहते हैं, वो कहते हैं कि ये देश की आम किसान के लिए इतना अच्छा ऐतिहासिक कानूनी पदक्षेप कभी किसी सरकार ने नहीं लिया, हम नहीं। तो अभी वो गिरगिरा रहा है, दूसरे संवैधानिक संस्था का मदद ले रहा है ताकि इस कठिनाई से बच के निकले, नहीं तो 26 जनवरी क्या होता किसी को मालूम नहीं। तो वो दूसरी मुद्दा है, ये हम चाहते हैं कि राज्यसभा में जिस तरह ये पाई ये कभी भी हिंदुस्तान के इतिहास में नहीं पाई। पार्लियामेंट अभी वो इंस्टीट्यूशन नहीं रहा, पार्लियामेंट को महत्व को जिस तरह उन्होंने ठुकराया, इसको लिए भी हमें ये जो जन संसद है, आपकी जो आवाज है, वो जमन से बुलंदी तक पहुंचना जरूरी है। दूसरी बात है सॉरी एक्सेंड सर, ये जो बिल आएगा उसका बारे में पत्रकार लोग जब सरकार से पूछा कि आप किस किस से चर्चा किया, मैं सबसे चर्चा किया, किसान संगठनों से किया, हाँ बहुत सारे किसान संगठनों से चर्चा किया, हजारों सेमिनार किया, वेबिनार किया, फिर दिल्ली का कोई मीडिया आरटीआई किया और आरटीआई के जवाब में उन्होंने पूछा था सरकार से, कमिश्नर से, इंफॉर्मेशन कमिश्नर से, कि कोई किसान ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के साथ आपने चर्चा किया कि नहीं, इस बारे में कोई भी रिकॉर्ड है तो मुझे हमें दिया जाए, तो बताया गया कि हमारा पास ऐसा कोई रिकॉर्ड है नहीं, इंफॉर्मेशन कमीशन इन राइटिंग जवाब दिया, और हमारे देश की कानून मंत्री और कृषि मंत्री चिल्ला चिल्ला के बोल रहे थे, सबके साथ चर्चा हुआ, किसानों के संस्था से भी चर्चा हुआ, इतना बड़ा बेबुनियाद झूठ सारे हिंदुस्तान को उन्होंने एक दफे नहीं कई दफे बोला, और उनको अगर सरकारी सरकार किसी से मीटिंग करते हैं तो उसको रिकॉर्ड बनती है, सब जानते हैं कि उसका मिनट्स बनती है, और इंफॉर्मेशन कमीशन बोल रहे हैं कि हमारा पास कोई रिकॉर्ड है, तो ये धोखाबाजों का सरकार है, ये करते रहेगा, आगे और भी करेगा, अभी थोड़ा फंस गए, सोच भी नहीं सकते कि लाखों की संख्या में लोग अपने परिवार लेके और उस 2 डिग्री टेम्परेचर में 40 दिन से ज्यादा समय वो नेशनल हाईवे में एकदम गांधी जी की दिखाया हुआ रास्ते पर एकदम पीसफुली देर हुए जवानों से, ये किसी को मालूम नहीं था, वो सोचा था और एक दूसरा शाहीन बाग बनाया जाएगा जहां बताया जाएगा जो भी विरोध कर रहे हैं गोली मारो सालों को, केंद्रीय मंत्री बोला था शाहीन बाग में, तो इस बार उस मौका मिला नहीं, ये बोला था पहले कांग्रेस मुक्त भारत, अभी ये विरोधी मुक्त भारत चाहते हैं, और विरोधी सिर्फ राजनीतिक कर जैसे पत्रकार लोग हैं, जैसे आप लोग सिविल सोसाइटी का नेतृत्व दे रहे हैं, वकील है, जर्नलिस्ट है, किसी को भी कोई भी अगर थोड़ा सा भी एक शब्द सरकार के खिलाफ बोलेंगे, जैसे रामचंद्र गोह को भी लाठी खाने पड़ा, तो आप लोगों को भी खिलाफ कुछ पत्रकार लोगों के खिलाफ सिडिशन का चार्ज दिया गया, तो ऐसा एक आतंक का माहौल पैदा हुआ उस समय, इस जन संसद का जरूरत सबसे ज्यादा हिंदुस्तान की जनता महसूस कर रहा है कि ऐसा एक होना चाहिए, कि सारा देश में एक आवाज उठाना है कि हम एक है इस कई मुद्दों पर, खास करके हमारे जो अन्नदाता है, दूसरे जो हमारे मजदूर लोग है, जो काला कानून नया लेबर लेबर लॉज अमेंडमेंट लॉज वो भी काला कानून है, तो इस सब के बारे में इनको चर्चा होना चाहिए। अब आपका सवाल है कि मिनिमम सपोर्ट प्राइस कैसे इंश्योर किया जाएगा, मिनिमम सपोर्ट प्राइस 60s में चालू हुआ, 1960s उस समय से आज तक ये कभी भी जिस उद्देश्य के लिए जिस ऑब्जेक्टिव के लिए किया गया था ये अभी तक फुलफिल तो हुआ नहीं, यहाँ तक कि पिछले साल प्लानिंग कमीशन का एक वरिष्ठ अभी तक प्लानिंग कमीशन मर गया, वो क्या नीति आयोग ने क्या आया गया, वो फर्जी चित्र बनाते हो लोग वहां बैठ के, दिस व्हाइट एलिफेंट ऑल्सो मस्ट गो, तो वहाँ वो लोग बोल रहे हैं उनका एक वरिष्ठ सदस्य कि ये तो ऐलान करते हैं MSP कई डजन फसल के लिए, लेकिन वास्तव में 4-5 से ज्यादा फसल का MSP किसी को नहीं मिलता है, तो MSP में वो जो स्वामीनाथन रिपोर्ट का जो फॉर्मूला है उसमें भी 2 फॉर्मूला है, तो A2+ ऐसा कुछ है कि ये सब ध्यान से इसको हमको देखना है, इसको अगर डेवलप करना है और भी अच्छा करना है, इसको भी हमको कोशिश जारी रखना चाहिए MSP के लिए, और इसमें राज्य सरकार का भागीदारी कैसे होगा, अभी एग्रीकल्चर प्रशांत भूषण जी आपके साथ अभी है कि नहीं मुझे मालूम नहीं, लेकिन वो हमारे देश की जाने हुए वकील भी हैं माने हुए, तो मैं उनसे निवेदन करना चाहता हूँ कि अब थोड़ा हम लोगों को थोड़ा दिशा दिखाइए कि एग्रीकल्चर एसेंशियल स्टेट सब्जेक्ट स्टेट लिस्ट में, लेकिन फिर भी ये लोग कर रहे हैं, तो इसमें कोई कानूनी रास्ता है कि नहीं जहाँ स्टेट अपना दवा डाल सकते हैं कि हमारा सब्जेक्ट पर आपका ये जो इंट्रूशन हो रहा है हर समय, इसको थोड़ा बंद करने का तरीका क्या है, इस बारे में आप थोड़ा राय दिखाइए। तीसरी बात यह है कि मैं संक्षेप में बोलना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि मुझे भी और कहीं जाना है, आप लोगों को भी समय का पाबंद है, तो मैं आप सबसे सिर्फ यही निवेदन करना चाहता हूँ कि जिस तरह आपने आज फिर कई सालों के बाद एक साथ होकर हम देश की जनता को भरोसा देने के लिए ये जो कलम सूची लिया हमारे पार्टी तृणमूल कांग्रेस होल हार्टेडली इसको सपोर्ट करते हैं और आगे जो भी आप कदम उठाइएगा आपके साथ तृणमूल कांग्रेस हमेशा खड़ा रहेगा, ये वादा मैं करता हूँ। फॉर्म लॉ के बारे में जो आपने बोला कि स्पेशल सेशन होना चाहिए कि नहीं, इसको रिपील होना चाहिए कि नहीं, अब तो मुद्दा सुप्रीम कोर्ट में चला गया, अब तो तारीख पे तारीख, तारीख पे तारीख, तारीख पे तारीख होता रहेगा। कमेटी कौन बनेगा, कौन बनाएगा, सरकार बनाएगा कि सुप्रीम कोर्ट बनाएगा, वो कमेटी को मानने के लिए हमारे किसान भाई तैयार है कि नहीं है, ये सारे सवाल है। तो अभी थोड़ा सिचुएशन फ्लूइड सिचुएशन है, तो मैं इस बारे में कहना चाहता हूँ कि तू ये स्पेशल सेशन तो होना ही चाहिए, ना तो सिलेक्ट कमेटी में भेजा गया जो आप बोल रहे थे अभी थोड़ी देर पहले कि सिर्फ पार्लियामेंट्री लोग चर्चा करेगा, नहीं, सिलेक्ट कमेटी को भेजो, ज्वाइंट सिलेक्ट कमेटी, और ये ज्वाइंट सिलेक्ट कमेटी मस्ट विजिट ऑल स्टेट हेडक्वार्टर्स इनवाइटिंग ऑल किसान ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस एंड अदर सिविल ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस टू लिसन देम एंड टू इंक्लूड देयर रिकमेंडेशंस एडिक्वेटली इन देयर रिपोर्ट बिफोर द पार्लियामेंट एंड ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दैट रिपोर्ट देयर शुड बी अ थ्रेडबेयर डिस्कशन at least for 1 week's session. This is my suggestion, subject to approval and acceptance by other stakeholders. Now, the last question that has been raised, that what measures should central government say? Other measures should be taken to alleviate the situation. It's a loan. अच्छा ये loan हम क्यों देते हैं? किसको देते हैं? Farmers के नाम पे. ज़्यादा समय आप देखिएगा ये loan जो rich farmers हैं उनके पॉकेट में जाता है, जो स्मॉल फार्मर्स है, मार्जिनल फार्मर्स है, किसी बैंक ने उसको पैसा नहीं देते क्योंकि वो जानते हैं कि ये तो पैसा वापस नहीं दे पाएंगे, इसका ये नहीं कैपेबिलिटी नहीं है, तो इसलिए जानबूझ के रिच फार्मर्स को देते हैं। और कुछ दिनों के बाद दाड़ाबाजी शुरू हो जाता है, लोन वेव करो, चुनाव आ जाता है और चुनाव की पहले उनको वोट खरीदने के लिए कोई भी सरकार, कोई भी पार्टी वो लोन वेव कर देता है। मेरे ख्याल से ये एक विचित्र ये है सिस्टम है, इसको खत्म करना चाहिए, या तो आप सब्सिडी दो या लोन, फिर लोन वेवर, ऐसा मत करो, ये सिलसिला बरसों से चल रहा है, ये एंटीथीसिस है। लोन अगर है तो लोन तो वापस देने ही पड़ेगा, और लोन का तुम वेवर देते हो तो उसको लोन मत करो, उसको बोलो सब्सिडी। ये मेरे आपसे निवेदन है, बहुत धन्यवाद कि आपने मौका दिया और फिर से हमारे बात आपने सुना, इसके लिए मैं आप सबका आभार। नमस्कार।
थैंक यू सो मच मिस्टर, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर दैट। द नेक्स्ट स्पीकर इज कॉमरेड दीपांकर भट्टाचार्य ऑफ द CPIML लिबरेशन। कॉमरेड दीपांकर, आई नो यू जॉइंड जस्ट अ फ्यू मिनट्स अगो, have you got those four questions before you, or would you like me to repeat them? Which
I've got all the questions. In fact, I was here all along. I've been I'm listening to the previous speakers. So thank you for this today's event, and at the outset let me make it very clear that we stand absolutely firmly with our fighting farmers. So the basic demands of the farmers, that is outright repeal of these three disastrous anti-farmer laws, I think we stand with this demand. There can be no pause button. We don't support any kind of diversionary tactics or delaying dilatory tactics on the part of the government. So I think it's absolutely very clear what the farmers are demanding, the repeal of the three laws, and also a repeal of the electricity bill 2020. And I think I have been just reading Nitin Gadkari's interview in the Indian Express, and that made it very clear why the government has come out with these bills. He has said that the two basic problems are that we have surplus food grain production in the country, and MSP is way higher than the prevailing market price. So basically they want to subject farmers to market price And in the name of sort of tackling this whole problem of surplus food grain production, they want to change, shift agriculture from food grains to biofuel or other commercial crops for corporate profits. So these are the two fundamental objectives of the central government. Now, let us be very clear that on the one hand, we have India slipping in the hunger index. On the one hand, we have hunger deaths in the country. So if we still have surplus food grains production, if our godowns are overflowing, it's because of the crisis of our public distribution system. So the moment we have a universal effective public distribution system, which can actually cater to the needs of the people, I don't think we will really have a problem of surplus food grain production. And this idea to shift from food grains to biofuel and other commercial crops, I think this is a disastrous idea. On the one hand, the government is talking of Atmanirbhar Bharat, but the basic parameter of self-sufficiency is, I think, food security. And once again, they will make India dependent on that American wheats and Australian wheats. I think this is what Punjab and the entire country's farmers, they are opposed to. Number two, they have made it very clear that MSP, the actual market price which prevails, in most places, the farmers do not get the advantage of MSP. It's only in Punjab and maybe part of Haryana where this whole agricultural marketing system works at the moment. And this is why the farmers are protesting there most vocally. In many other parts of the country, the farmers do not really get the advantage of MSP. And they are actually forced, it's a kind of distress sell that farmers are subjected to. So they don't get MSP. So I think that's why it's very clear to understand that why farmers are insisting on MSP. And when they talk about MSP, I think we demand not just a legal guarantee of the MSP. It's not enough for the government to only declare a price. It's also must be mandatory for the government to ensure of adequate procurement, timely procurement and timely payment. These are things which farmers have been experiencing problems and they have not been getting it. We were also part of the farmers movement before 2019 elections, the 2018 big farmers agitation that you mentioned. And those two demands of a loan waiver, freedom from debt and MSP as recommended by the Swaminathan Commission. There are also other demands which came up in the course of the agitation. Demands which are basically demands of marginal farmers, sharecroppers. And I think another important demand which farmers are also raising, that is cheaper inputs. So we cannot just have very expensive agriculture and just match that by demanding higher prices of our crops. But I think cheapening agriculture, making the inputs more easily available and affordable. So affordability of inputs, that's also another key demand, and which I think if ensured by governments, then that will go a long way to help the smaller marginal farmers who cannot afford this growing prices of input. Now, I think we are in a stage where the whole country, I think, has got the message. It's not just Punjab farmers. And in fact, I find it very interesting because we communists have all along been accused of divide, looking at farmers not as a community, but talking about class differentiation within farmers. So rich farmers and marginal farmers and small farmers and landless farmers and so on and so forth. And now the government is telling us that this is a rich farmers movement. So this is a movement of the Kulak lobby and poor farmers, they have nothing to do with it. But I think farmers cutting across their size class, I think they have got the message. So this is a movement of the entire agricultural population. I think India's rural and urban poor, they have also got the message that this sounds a death knell for whatever public distribution system we have, whatever notional food security we still have in the country. So for defense of food security and for the rationing system, I think the urban and rural poor, they are fully supporting this movement. And the most important question is, now this is a threat to our democracy, the way the bills were passed. And now when the farmers are demanding, the government has canceled the winter session of parliament and our Niti Aayog chairman, he complains that we have too much of democracy. So when we actually democracy is being denied, being completely subverted in practice. So this is why it has also become a question of democracy. It's a question of federalism. So that's why I think across the board, all sections of Indian people who would like to defend India's democracy, who stand with the constitution of the country, who want a federal India, who want welfare economics, where the demands of our rural and urban poor, the working people will be met. I think they all are standing with the farmers today. Now we see the Supreme Court trying to intervene. Let us, I think the farmer, I looked at the farmer's statement yesterday issued by the farmers' organizations, and I stand with them. The court's observations vis-a-vis the government's attitude, I think these observations are quite welcome. But I think the court should also understand why for the last 2 months the farmers are here. So the farmers have made it very clear, and this is between the farmers and the government. The government has come out with ordinances first and then passed these laws by dubious means. Farmers are opposed to the laws, so let the laws be repealed. We support the idea of a special session of parliament, but I think even the repeal of the laws, the special session, let laws be repealed first, and then of course the entire agrarian crisis, the various dimensions of it, some dimensions have got some attention, but there are many other dimensions, as you talked about the climate change, various other aspects of it, which have not got adequate attention yet. So let there be a comprehensive parliament session to discuss every aspect of the agrarian crisis and to come out with some kind of a convincing, credible resolution of the agrarian crisis in support of India's agricultural population, in support of India's agriculture. And what the government is right now doing, let us not forget that in the first quarter of this 2020, when we had seen our GDP nosedive by close to 25%, it was only agriculture which recorded some 3% positive growth. And now that sector is being completely handed over to the Adanis and Ambanis, what the farmers popularly call the Company Raj. So we are with the farmers against Company Raj, and we are with the Indian people for democracy against this whole fascist onslaught on our democratic system. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Comrade Bhattacharya. Thank you very much. May I call upon Comrade D. Raja of the Communist Party of India to speak next, please. Comrade Raja.
Am I audible?
Very audible.
Okay. I thank every one of you.
Comrade Raja, you are aware of the questions before you, right? The four questions that the session requires you to address.
I think I understand English to that extent, to understand those.
Because I don't know when people are joining the meeting, so I'm just asking protectively, so to speak. Please go ahead. And
the paper. Okay. At the outset, I congratulate Ms. Senath and others for having this meaningful interaction. I must make it clear, my party, the CPI, has been supporting the farmer struggle since the beginning. Our kisans, our agricultural workers, they are also part of this movement. And all those class and mass organizations led by my party people are extending their support, solidarity, and party has been very much involved in the solidarity activities all over the country. As political party, we have demanded the repeal of these three agricultural laws. And we continue to support the farmers who are fighting against these laws. In fact, during Parliament last session, not the last session where these laws were enacted, our party opposed and our party voted against. And in Rajya Sabha, there was no vote also. That is another tragedy. Because I see Manoj Jha sitting and he knows what happened those days in Rajya Sabha. Friends, as far as the parliament session is concerned, it is not a new demand. Even before the farmers' struggle began, there was a demand that there should be a special session of the parliament to address the issues concerning Indian agriculture. As far as I am concerned, my party is concerned, ever since the neoliberal economic policies were introduced and implemented, Indian agriculture continues to be in crisis, deep crisis. Agrarian distress has become unprecedented. When farmers were committing suicide, Mr. Vajpayee was the chief prime minister. Vajpayee government claimed India shining. Now we have Mr. Modi as the prime minister. There is a tendency to attribute all credits to Mr. Modi. Some survey has come during COVID-19. He has done great job and he must be praised to the sky. But those people who do this, or I take the name, the BJP-RSS combined, should talk about where does India stand as far as human development index is concerned? Where does India stand as far as the hunger index is concerned? So we are witnessing an unprecedented inequality in the country. I am not speaking about the unprecedented inequality among the nations. Within our own nation, unprecedented inequality. The present government has been serving the interests of corporate houses, big business houses. What is the primary objective of these three agriculture laws? Nothing but to serve the interests of corporate houses and making Indian agriculture as a corporatized one. And it is known to all farmers, whether they are small, marginal, or medium, or rich, all agree the government is pushing corporatization of agriculture. Government is handing over agriculture to big corporate houses like Adani's, Ambani's. And the way the Adani's, Ambani's came out with statements trying to hoodwink the farmers, one should understand what is behind. So the cat is out of the bag, and Modi government is committed and determined to serve the interests of corporate houses. And I make it very clear. And parliament session, yes, there should be parliament session. And many people keep talking about MSP and Swaminathan Commission's report. And I had the opportunity to be in parliament when he was also in parliament. That way, we were colleagues in parliament, Ms. Swaminathan and myself. And I have great regard for Mr. Swaminathan. But the way Mr. Modi says, oh, yeah, all the recommendations of Swaminathan Commission have been implemented, it is a lie. total lie people should understand. Otherwise, why farmers come to the Delhi borders in this shivering cold? Why they are fighting and why they are agitating? This should be understood. It is not only question of MSP. I have written in Indian Express on these three laws, why we are demanding the repeal of three laws. I have spoken about the conditions of agricultural laborers, conditions of rural poor, because this is going to have disastrous impact on food security of the country, on public distribution of this country, everything. I have written in one piece in Indian Express. Now, I must point out certain other things. The parliament itself is becoming redundant. That is what should worry everybody, every concerned citizen. Parliament is the supreme institution in, and parliament represents the will of the people of the whole country. Parliament represents the whole nation with all its diversities. But today, parliament is made redundant. If at all parliament is used, that is used to implement the agenda of a particular political force, that is BJP, RSS combined. And the way they use parliament, now many things I can raise. The new education policy. What is this new education policy? Nothing but centralization, commercialization, and communalization. And these three laws, they got passed in parliament. There is a tendency of centralization of power in the hands. And that leads to, finally now, we are hearing one nation, one election. It went through one nation, one culture, one nation, one religion, then one nation, one tax, GST. And now, one nation, one election. This is what I am saying. India is not a monolith. India is a plural democracy, multi-party democracy. This is being undermined by the present dispensation regime. And I am asking, raising the question in related to agriculture. We have a huge rural poor population, but earlier we had certain targeted schemes for agricultural workers, tribal people of our country. There was tribal sub-plan. Where is that tribal sub-plan? There was special component plan for Dalits. What happened? Planning Commission was dismantled. Niti Aayog has been constituted. This Niti Aayog has taken up the job to privatize everything and privatize all public sector undertakings and making the government to abdicate its responsibility. That is what is happening. I myself raised several times in parliament, there should be central legislation for the welfare, for the security of agricultural workers, tribal people. It was not considered at all. And now all those targeted plans have gone. Niti Aayog is ruling this country. That is why we have come to a critical stage in our democracy. And now we will have to think how to fight this present regime and how to force this present regime. Good, the farmers have come together and yes, they are fighting despite whatever indictments the Supreme Court makes about the present government. Farmers understand what is going on. That's why they say we are here and we want the government to understand our position. Government should repeal all these laws and we are with farmers. And of course, the parliament is going to meet, whether it is a special session or not. It is a budget session. And I hope the members of parliament will raise this issue and force the government to repeal these laws in the interest of the nation, the interest of the country. So our party stands
yeah.
for having a special session or even in the present session
yeah.
To discuss these matters, agrarian crisis in detail, and in particular to repeal these three laws to begin with.
Yeah,
that's my position.
Thank you so much, Comrade Raja. Professor Manoj Jha of the RJD, may I request you to present your party's position?
Thank you. Thank you, Sainath ji. Thank you, everybody, and thank you, Janata Sansad. When the actual parliament is not there, at least you give a feel. And the time allotted to me is much more than the time I get in Rajya Sabha. So thank you once again. But I'll stick to my Rajya Sabha timing. I would begin by what Sainath ji said, that let's not call it simply a farm crisis. It's agrarian crisis. An agrarian crisis, it doesn't have a singular face all over India. It has, it's if we call it a disease, it has different symptoms in different states, even within states in different areas. I think that kind of, when we speak about decentralization, decentralized intervention, we must keep that in mind. Before coming to those four questions, I'll also say that when we talk about guaranteed legal framework or legal guarantee for MSP, I'm drawn to the appalling condition in Bihar. I tell you, the sugarcane, the maize, generally the MSP, what we call is 1800 something. But in my area, which is which produces lots of maize, last year the experience shows that it was 700 to 800. In fact, less than half of what the MSP says. Bihar is not counted. I mean, even the chief minister therein and others, Comrade Dipankar was here. They say that Bihar, Bihari farming communities are not affected by these farm laws. The reason being that they were badly affected 14, 15 years ago. And largely there has been a tendency in Bihar that the farmers, they crossed the line and became marginal. And then many of them have in fact got transmogrified into agricultural laborers, number one. In fact, many of you know, I was in the parliament, and you must remember this COVID arrangement of parliament when it was passed. We in Rajya Sabha, we were the sitting arrangement at four places. I was in Lok Sabha. Many of my colleagues were in Rajya Sabha, main chamber. Many of my colleagues were in lobbies, galleries. Now, you know what happens? When, even if we were agitated, the sitting arrangement made sure that people cannot come to the well, because, you know, COVID has helped the regimes all over the world a lot. Our regime has got huge support during the COVID pandemic in terms of how to appropriate the COVID situation in their favor or in passing legislation like this. You might not have forgotten, none of us will forget, the kind of images we saw in Rajya Sabha. And that should be seen in the context of building of a new parliament building. I remember I had a vice chancellor in Jamia Millia, and there was a new building, inauguration of a new building. And he warned us, he said, new cemented structures also have a tendency to convert themselves as a cemetery for thinking, for wisdom, and things like that. Similar things I can see. On one end, the democratic processes are being scuttled, and scuttled is an understatement. And on the other, you have new buildings, Central Vista, and things like that. We'll talk about it some day later. After losing in parliament, I would say losing, we had lost all hopes. But two things I would say that has given us hope. Last year, December, 2019, November, December, when CA was passed, we had lost hope. But, you know, roads, streets, localities gave us a sense of hope. Similarly, this time when these three laws were passed, we had lost hope. But then Delhi borders in last 46, 48 days, they have given us hope. So that hope is also for the opposition parties. I have no qualm in admitting that opposition parties have not been able to come out of their comfort zones. I mean, Twitter, Facebook, and occasional protest, that notwithstanding. But overall, in evolving a framework whereby we know it's a difficult time, COVID-like situation, but still, if farming communities could do it and could give us a sense that it is possible to send a message to this government, I think we have not done our bit. I won't say all of us have been very, very. So after losing, I and together with DMK, we were some of the political parties, we moved to Supreme Court. So when the Supreme Court is hearing petition today, apart from other petition, Rashtriya Janata Dal's petition is also there together with other petitions. So let's hope Supreme Court today means why it is called Supreme Court. So let's hope. I very strongly believe that a special session is needed, but a special session not bereft of holding parliamentary debate won't help. A special session would mean only when you know the distinction between monologue and a dialogue. This government loves monologue, particularly our prime minister. He's so much in love with his own voice. He loves to speak in his ecosystem, and he loves the reverberation of that voice, which keeps coming back to him. I think that won't help even if we call it a special session. One of my colleague had said that one idea could be after the debate in the special session, it should be sent to the select committee, because I don't believe stakeholder engagement has taken place. Even if it has taken place over the years, what people say, it has not arrived at, a consensual framework. I think that should be the idea. Yes, there is nothing but repeal. You know, this law does not have kintu parantu agar bagar ki gunjaish. If but, besides, notwithstanding, that won't help. I think for once, it should be repealed. And I also believe that when we talk about farming communities or overall agrarian crisis, we shouldn't forget the women farmers. As I said, state across the states, you have to look at different kind of problems, different symptoms. Similarly, for women farmers, we need to also evolve a kind of thinking whereby generally, whenever farmers are referred to as, it is the reference is in terms of he. I think we have good amount of substantial amount of data that he together with she should be used. And finally, I just said the implication of these laws are also about food security. One of my colleagues said, and I agree, that when I look at my state, Bihar, where the holdings are relatively small, you have to go for out-of-box thinking. And last, Sainathji, as a teacher in Delhi University, I teach social movement. And I must tell you that what I have seen, we were critique of Congress party governments, because as a student, we had fear of the police, but we never had the fear of being called anti-national, Pakistani, Khalistani. So the standard tricks they also applied to the farming communities. And I'm very glad that they did not stick, they did not take their fight to challenging the levels. They stuck to their core demands, and even with regard to courts, they have made it very clear: no committee, nothing, only repeal. And I stand by that. My party stands by that. Dipankarji is here on 30th of January, that is on the day of martyrdom of Bapu. Farmers across Bihar and our party, together with all other opposition parties, we are making a human chain as a kind of solidarity message to the farming communities. Thank you very much, sir. Jai Hind.
Professor Jha, one very quick question for a short answer.
You spoke about the need for replacing monologue with dialogue in parliament. Would you support, and I would say this question applies to all the speakers and parties, would you support the introduction of a practice in the Indian parliament that is fairly established in several other democracies, which is public hearings where the victims of the agrarian crisis can stand on the floor of parliament and address parliament and the nation on what they think the crisis?
200%. 200%, Sainaji. I don't believe many a time even parliament, when they say, even a committee meeting, standing committee meeting, that it's a secret, please don't carry it forward, carry it outside. I believe that parliament itself is a forum which should be transparent, and it has to engage 24/7. For the people they are meant to represent. I agree 100%. And I remember you had said similar thing when you had come to Delhi School of Social Work, where I'm teaching even now. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The next speaker I call upon, Dr. D. Ravi Kumar of the VCK Tamil Nadu, the Vidutale Chirutaigal Katchi. Dr. Ravi Kumar, would you please address us on this question?
Thanks to everybody. Thanks for the opportunity to participate in the Janata Parliament. My thanks to particularly to Dr. Suresh of UCL and Dr. Franco. So we have assembled in a critical juncture of our democracy. We are eagerly waiting about the Supreme Court verdict. What is coming from words of our highest judiciary about our farmers? Yesterday, the Chief Justice of India very passionately expressed his views about the farmers' struggle. But they never mention, already we have lost more than 60 lives of our farmers. So this is very, very painful. We are speaking about the struggle of farmers in a safe atmosphere. But farmers are suffering in a very bad temperature, and day by day they are losing their lives. The parliament, after the BJP came to power, they are slowly scuttling the process of parliamentary democracy. They have passed many bills as money bills, particularly the demonetization bill, the Aadhaar bill. Unfortunately, our Supreme Court also upheld the passing of Aadhaar bill as money bill. So why they chose the money bill way? Because they have no majority in the upper house of our parliament. So they want to bypass the parliamentary system to pass a law. Even now, in these farm bills also, they have passed in the Lok Sabha because they have a sufficient majority in Lok Sabha. But on that particular day, they had no majority in Rajya Sabha. So they subverted the process in the Rajya Sabha. Many members asked for voting, particularly Siva from DMK and other members from Congress. Even after the request to put the bill for voting, the speaker avoided voting and instead he chose the voice voting method. They have announced amid chaos the passing of the law. Yesterday, the Supreme Court also mentioned indirectly these farm laws are not passed after due consultation. So, not only the farm laws, the other laws also, we are also waiting to know the fate of the Aadhaar review cases. Yesterday, the Supreme Court heard the case, I think, in the chamber, the review petition. But what was the outcome, we get to know. So this government, this BJP government, completely ignoring the due process and also scuttling the parliamentary procedures in passing laws. First, they passed these farm laws as ordinance, and then they hurriedly convened the Lok Sabha during the time of pandemic, and passed these laws in undemocratic manner. So they are killing the parliamentary democracy. There is a important thing to note. Not only farm laws, other laws also, they are doing the same. So we have to oppose not only the process of farm laws and the bad aspects of farm laws, also to oppose Aadhaar and demonetization and other laws passed by them, and even scrapping of Article 370 and others. So now, what is the possibility available to a parliamentarian? Now they have announced the convening of Parliament on 29th. The budget session is going to be started on 29th. They are going to introduce the budget on February 1st. And the total days allotted for discussion is very few. First, they allotted only 2 weeks, then 4 weeks, only 6 weeks. That too, only for 4 hours a day. So, no space is there to discuss anything meaningful. So not only this time, even last year, they stifled the voices of the opposition. They reduced the time, and even for 0 hour, they're not allowing a 0 hour discussion every day. And they allot the time only in late evening, even in late night. When we stand to speak in the 0 hour, so in the parliament, nobody was there. Only few people. They are also waiting for their turn to speak. So we are left with no choice other than to speak in the midnight in the presence of a few of our friends. So the possibility of discussion about any law is not available in the parliament nowadays. So we have to raise our voice for more time, more space, particularly for opposition, to vent out the grievances, went out the demand. So this is also an important matter, I think. So in this, the upcoming section, we are planning to insist for a special session of parliament to discuss exclusively the three formulas, because last time they didn't give much time, enough time. So we are planning to insist for a special session. So not only the parliament members, if we insist, we cannot win, because we are very few in the House, particularly in Lok Sabha. So we ask your support, particularly the civil society, support of civil society and other organizations, to raise your voice for a special session in the parliament to discuss the farm laws. Because these three farm laws are not only against farmers, so not only against the landholders, they are against the entire population. So from the history, we know during the time of British, lakhs and lakhs of people were died in the famine because of the agriculture policies adopted by the colonial government. Only after independence, the production has increased, the new techniques were adopted, and even during pandemic, the statistical office has released a recent report. They have alerted us the economy is in a bear shape. It is in a negative growth of 7.7%. And the only green shoot is agriculture. The agriculture sector is growing, that too around 3%, but it is the only hope left to the people of India. But the farm laws is aimed to destroy that offshoots also. If they implement these farm laws fully, definitely we'll see again the deaths of famine, which happened during British period. So they did not worry about anything. They didn't care about the lives of people. They didn't care about the farmers. They didn't care about the public. They only care about the corporate front. They are making policies, they are making decisions only for protecting their corporate friend. So they are using the public sector banks to help their corporate friend. They plundered the public sector banks. That's why they have merged, amalgamated many banks only because of the corporate's failure to repay the loan. And recently, the Karur Vysya Bank, the Lakshmi Vilas Bank, which was given to a Singapore-based private bank, it's also because of the failure of corporates. So the government intentionally killing the public sector banks to help corporate. And they are also using the other sectors of the government to help the corporates. Now they are aiming at the agriculture sector to complete their program. If we allow these farm laws, then we never get back our land or our rights to food, everything. So this is a fight not only against the farm laws, it's a fight against corporates.
Yes.
It's a fight against the government, which is implementing the corporate plans only. So we should raise our voice collectively to compel the government to convene a special session to discuss the farm laws and repeal the three dangerous laws. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ravi Kumar. May I call upon Mr. G. Devarajan of the All India Forward Bloc to state this party's position next, please. Mr. Devarajan.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me for this important Kisan Parliament. Though the whole nation is now discussing this issue, and even our Supreme Court is also deliberating on this issue. And it is a good idea that a special session of our parliament to be convened to discuss exclusively on this farmers' distress. And our party is supporting that idea. And while extending our solidarity to the fighting farmers, and in fact, the issue of the farmers, the agony which they are now facing, we had been discussing since long, even before submitting this ordinance to the parliament. And I'm happy that Mr. Sainarji is presiding this session, and his write-ups, his articles, etc., become engine for our this farmers movement across the country, no doubt. And of course, I met the fighting farmers at Singhu border and Ghazipur border, and I participated the struggle, and I spoke also at Singhu border on behalf of our Kisan organization, and I met some of the leaders. And I was astonished to see their determination and the enthusiasm of the members of the farmers' family for participating in such a fantastic strike. And rather they have taken it as their, it is a strike for their survival. So I think that it is the responsibility of the civil society to stand with them. And because after all, everybody knows they are the real annadada of our country. So whenever they are in crisis, that means the country is in crisis. It is also a fact that earlier, the major chunk of our GDP comes from agriculture. Now the government is now projecting the reports that the proportion from GDP from agriculture is lesser than industry and service sector, etc. But they didn't add the value added products come from agriculture products that is never put into the part of agriculture activity. And the other side also, this animalist battery and etc. also never been added. So there is a concerted effort that to camouflage or suppress the real income, the real contribution from the farming sector to our country. So I think that there also the civil society organization have to interfere, and we have to educate the people or make awareness that this is the real picture. And the issue which these farmers are raising, it is not, I don't think that it is only for these three laws. And of course, these three laws are draconian, not of it all. And if the farmers are agitating against these laws, that means the farmers don't need these laws. So it is the government's responsibility. If it is a responsive government, or it is a responsive government, then they have to repeal these laws. If the farmers are saying that, no, we don't need the freedom which you are talking about through your monkey bath and whatever source, and this the big letter which the agriculture minister has wrote to the nation and the farmers, that this is the these are the laws meant for your freedom, for selling your produces, your economic freedom, and etc., etc. So, but the farmers says no, we don't need such freedom. But you are you mean that what type of freedom? The only thing is that ये जो सिर दर्द का इलाज तो सिर काट के फेंकना तो नहीं है. If you have a headache, you have to diagnose what is the problem. Then you treat. Instead of that, chopping of head is not the solution or it is not the treatment. So whatever the lacuna or amenities prevailing in this APMC or the mandi system, then you have to address the system equally and to discuss with the people, those who are concerned. There are farmers organization, there are mandi organization, they discuss with them and settle the issues. Regarding this MSP also, they are asking that if you legalize MSP, let the state government, so it is a state matter, let them decide. The agriculture produces comes through different states, through different climatic condition, different food habits. These are all the part and parcel of agriculture production. So let the state also decide what will be the MSP for rice, what will be the MSP for paddy. And there is no uniform
MSP, right?
Kerala is giving more than 26 rupees per kg rice. Then you are not getting this much of money in Bihar or in Madhya Pradesh. And now earlier Punjab was number one in the wheat production. Now Madhya Pradesh has become number one in wheat production. So all these statistics shows that each state government has its own stake to say about MSP and all. So let them decide. And it must be legalized that there must be an MSP and nobody have the right to purchase these agriculture producers less than this MSP. So these are the minimum things that the farmers are asking. Secondly, for what purpose you have amended this Essential Commodities Act? And for what purpose this bill has been brought and why this bill has been enacted? It is to stop black marketing, hoarding. And if you legalize hoarding and black marketing, automatically the prices will go up. And anyway, the farmers will not be benefited out of this hoarding and black market. It is the middlemen. It is the corporates, those who are already in the picture. Already they are procuring the thing, producers. They will be benefited, not the farmers, not the consumers. So you have some sort of alienation, or you have now hell-bent to satiate the interest of the corporates with those who supported you, those who are supporting you. It is not in favor of the farmers. So these the issues which the farmers are raising, it is a genuine issues, there is no doubt at all. And the political parties across their ideology or whatever may be the color of their flags and etc., they should also come forward. And at the same time, it has nothing to do with what the government is talking about, that there are people, they are anti-national and they are Khalistanis, all this. This is the way they have to divide the struggling the movements. Whenever such type of movement, whether it is a farmers movement or it is a movement for citizenship, whether it is a movement for youth rights, whether it is a movement for women rights, whatever the movement comes up, then this is the easy way to destabilize the movement, that they are all anti-nationals. They belong to this group, they belong to that group and all. So this has to be thought of with, and of course the civil society and the political parties have a major role to play in extending their support to the agitating farmers. And after all, it is not for the farmers, it is for the survival of our country. So of course the All India Forward Bloc and its farmers organization and its other mass organizations also definitely is with the struggling farmers, and we will be there. And whatever the resolutions, whatever the action programs, whatever the movement which we are throwing up and which we are unleashing in different ways, and we will also be there. And I extend our entire support and solidarity for this moment. Thank you very much. Jai. Sainath ji, please unmute your phone.
Yeah, Sainath. I'm sorry. Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Devarajan. Could I call on Mr. Ghanshyam Tiwari of the Samajwadi Party to speak next, please?
Thank you so much. It is a privilege for me to speak and share my views in front of people who I have admired for their knowledge, for their resilience, and for their public missions. I believe that we speak at a time when Supreme Court is discussing this, and the battle, the fight that has been led by farmers and supported by political parties, especially those in opposition, And on the other hand, foo-fooed, indignified by ministers, members of parliament, chief ministers of BJP, is right now at a pivotal moment. And at this pivotal moment, it has become clear that one, the government did not do adequate consultations. The law minister who did a press conference at a BJP at BJP headquarters saying that 92 lakh consultations were made was clearly lying, because the government could not answer the question in front of the Supreme Court when the Supreme Court said that, did you do any serious consultations? Second, in the Supreme Court yesterday, when it was mentioned that did the court see what happened in Rajya Sabha, it is clear that the government did not respond, because they know that what happened was in Rajya Sabha would remain a black day for our electoral democratic process. So from that perspective, one, we as a party, and Akhilesh Yadavji has said, he said that in December too, and we continue to say this, that we as a party are steadfast on the farmer demand that these black laws created on a framework of deceit and with a purpose of deceit must be fully repealed. Second, that we are with the farmers to strengthen their battle. We believe that the farmers are leading this, and the political parties have a role to support it and make it truly a farmer versus government discourse, so that the government has no easy way to destroy the legitimacy of this battle. The government has failed because of the resilience of the farmers. The government went in thinking that farmers are weak, they come from only one state, they could be debranded, they will run out of resources. And when the Supreme Court yesterday said that they worry about loss of life, the question is, where does this worry come from? This worry does not come from the peaceful dharna of farmers, where more than 60 farmers have laid down their lives. This worry comes from the fact that the court knows that the government has a sense of dictatorial mind and might. And if something that leads to loss of life, it will not come from an action taken by farmers. It will come from the action taken by the government. So I think the from a political standpoint, we are with the farmers on their demand to repeal these laws. We are with the farmers in their demand that a fresh thought has to be put in thinking about these laws. Proper consultations have to be made. States have to be given their adequate place and position. And in addition, we are with the leaders of opposition who say that the parliament must decide, must have a role to play, and a session of parliament must be part of the process to get back to normalcy before solutions could be developed. In terms of what solutions can exist, I think there are eminent people here and across the country who have worked sincerely with knowledge, with deep grassroots experience to look at what solutions can emerge. I, as somebody who has worked in the field of technology and education and use of technology for youth and children in smaller towns and cities and villages, I believe that technology do offer a source of data and a source of proliferating data solutions. And at some point in time, those amongst us who have a deeper understanding of technology should also build that as a source of strength for the civil society movement and also the political movement when it comes to supporting the marginalized classes or the weaker classes. I think from that perspective, I would also want to suggest to the group that we must look at deep use of technology to enlighten us about solutions that can be incorporated, both from reducing the risks faced by marginal farmers to the opportunities that may exist for the farmers to further work towards their prosperity. One of the things that is clear for me as somebody who's worked with different startups also in the field of enabling solutions for the poor, for the low income groups, it is very clear that any enterprise, within any enterprise, the actor of the enterprise that is closest to the consumer, right, has the highest bargaining power in that entire supply chain. And the next actor that has second highest bargaining power is the one that enables the actor to be closest to the consumer. So in the frame of new laws, the actors who will be closest to the consumer are the retail companies, the Amazons or the marts, various marts that are coming together. And behind them would be the infrastructure companies such as Adani. And the farm gate, which is where the farmers are, millions of farmers are there. They are the weakest link in this model that the government is envisioning. So whenever this model that the government wanted to put out comes into force, it is absolutely clear that among the primary actors that take the farm produce to the consumer, the weakest link would be millions of farmers. And the government did try through deceit to further weaken them by taking away their ability to go to seek justice by creating alternate ways around mandis, which may not have the same level of accountability. So I think each of us have to be very vigilant. This government came with land acquisition changes in 2015, could not succeed. Now they have come with this. With every force that they acquire through their propaganda-based politics, they will go back and seek more power from the vulnerable classes and the masses. So we as a political party will continue to be vigilant alongside the civil society. We will work towards solutions, and we stand with the farmers, and we stand with everyone in this forum who says that the government has cheated, it cannot be trusted, and these laws must be repealed. Thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to share my views.
Thank you so much, Ghanshyamji. The next speaker is Comrade Sitaram Yechuri of the CPIN. Sitaram?
Thanks, Sai. Sainath is a bit. And everybody else who is present here. And thank you very much for organizing this session, which is absolutely necessary in today's conditions, in which there's still a great deal of uncertainty over how this Kisan struggle will proceed. The Supreme Court has said that it is going to issue the orders today. The Sanyukt Kisan Morcha yesterday issued a press release saying that they are not prepared to talk to any committee. There's no need for any committee to step in. The issue is between the government and the Kisan organizations. Very correctly, we support that position. It's the government that has to be answerable. And for the government to make it answerable, this bundle of lies that they're spreading against these entire reforms that they brought about, that are already exposed, that need to be continuously more exposed. This whole talk of consultations. If there were consultations, why was it that in the parliament when we said let it go to a select committee, that was not allowed? Why was it in such a hurry that people who asked for a division of vote in the Rajya Sabha were suspended? And why were these bills passed in a din, in a truncated session of parliament? The answer is very clear. There's obviously certain deals that are behind this with the big corporate giants. And corporates wanting to take control of agriculture, its markets, its produce. In today's situation of global economic crisis, one can understand. In order to maintain their levels of profit or in fact increase them further, they require new areas of operation, and agriculture today is the goose that lays the golden egg as far as India is concerned. So the targeting of these giant corporates, the two of them especially, by the farmers is absolutely spot on. And this is where the entire issue comes down to it, that these farm laws are meant not for the welfare of India, not for the welfare of our annadatas, our kisans, but for soaring rates of profit for your corporate world. Now, having said that, this cannot saying that we all the political parties ask for agrarian reforms, but when the reforms are brought in, we are opposing it. Everybody is for agrarian reforms, but what sort of reforms? These are not the reforms that is going to help Indian agriculture or strengthen India's food security. If you want to strengthen India's food security, the question is to empower our kisans, empower our farmers. And that empowering can be done through, needs to be done through a series of reforms. wherein we'll have to bring in seriously, and the CPIM has been suggesting such reforms in the past, have been saying so we have to consider seriously the question of cooperative farms in terms of cooperatives operating in terms of production and marketing. It's not only cooperatives for providing finance to the farmers, but it is also in terms of production for marketing. And this is essential in order to use higher technology, which requires larger farms. And such cooperative methods are absolutely essential. We have been suggesting that for many, many years. Many other reforms we have been suggesting. But even the issue of MSP. You see, first of all, I think all of us must be very clear in our understanding that MSP is meaningless unless there is procurement. If there is no procurement, MSC declaration is meaningless, which is what is happening in large parts of the country. And that is why whatever is declared also, the Kisan doesn't get that amount. But the definition of what is the MSP, all of us have agreed that we go by the Swaminathan Commission's thing of C2 plus 50%. That has never been implemented by the government, whatever be the claims of the Prime Minister. And wherever it is implemented, only 6% of our farmers are benefiting out of this MSP. MSP has to cover every single farmer. It has to cover every single crop. And until that sort of an MSP is brought about, it cannot be effective. I had written way back in 2017, when I was still a member of the parliament, to the Prime Minister, asking the government to bring a law for the Kisans to have the right to sell at MSP. This law is something we asked for. There's no, of course, no acknowledgement of that letter also, forget any reply. And then we reiterated this in our election manifesto, that there has to be a law by which anybody who's buying at less than the MSP will have to be prosecuted criminally. But this is something that the government refuses to agree. So the question right now is that these farm laws, I mean, we can go into the criticism of what this entire thing means, and all of us are well versed with it. There's no need to repeat all those issues. But the question right now is that they should be, and immediately these must be repealed, these laws. Then the government, not the question of any committee, the government must directly sit down with the farmers' representatives and talk about larger agrarian reforms, and then consult all the other stakeholders, and then bring new laws or new reforms in the parliament for its consideration and adoption. That is the only course that is there left now for the government. They'll have to be forced to do this. They're using the Supreme Court as today an escape route. This is exactly what the Supreme Court did with the Central Vista also. They stayed the Central Vista for 1 month, and after that appointed a committee, and after that said the committee recommendations have come, everything is fine, and they cleared it. Now, this is exactly the modus operandi that they are wanting to utilize for this Kisan struggle also. This cannot be allowed. So therefore, I'm happy to join with all others who are supporting the farmers, and will continue to support them. And right now, very correctly and very wisely, the farmer organizations have said that no political leader should come there to address them. And I think it is a very correct thing, because that has been the entire canard of the Prime Minister and the government, saying that politicians are behind them. Day before yesterday, when the Haryana Chief Minister was not allowed to hold his meeting, what was the charge he made? That farmers are very peaceful. It is the politicians who are bringing in outsiders to create these disturbances. So our support will be there from the outside. We'll continue to support in various ways, which we are already doing. But the question is simple. The solution is only one. Repeal these laws, sit with the farmers, sit with all the stakeholders, the government directly, and then discuss agrarian reforms and bring in new reforms and new laws. So the CPIM fully supports this direction and will continue to support it. And thank you once again for taking this initiative, which is both timely and necessary. Thank you, Sai.
Sitaram, a couple of questions for you. One is, you do support the idea of a special session that will exclusively focus on the larger agrarian crisis and related issues.
Yes, of course. Yeah. Of course. I mean, we asked for this. We asked for this earlier. And we asked for this. We asked for a special session, even if necessary, only a two-day session, but discuss this issue.
Yeah. The second thing is more complicated. I mean, you made the point about how you believe the government is trying to damn the farmers' movement by questioning its political affiliations and saying that it's driven by political parties behind the scenes. And that is fairly clear, but I also understand that it's also obvious that the political parties therefore want to play this in a way that does not respond to this in a way that does not give the government that excuse. However, is it not possible at this stage with the movements of the farmers reaching the stage for the political parties independently, as they did in the 2018 November, can the political parties that supported these demands then and now, can they meet, have a physical meeting and declare that this entire nation is looking at these issues and this is where we stand? Can they do that as a public meeting?
Of course they can. Of course they can. And that is what we are trying to do. And if you remember, Sainath, that during the course of these nearly 50 days, the political parties have jointly issued statements, including a wide cross-section, starting from the Congress to the Nationalist Congress Party to Samajwadi Party to the RJD, and all the leaders, the topmost leaders of these parties have together signed, issued joint statements, and a delegation on behalf of all of us went and met the President of India, demanding exactly this. So we are now also working out that there should be a political intervention by the political parties independently on this issue. And for that, unfortunately, we do not have a system whereby MPs can summon a parliament or requisition a parliament. But political parties are saying, immediately call a session of the parliament. Anyway, the budget session is coming. Repeal these laws and then discuss the reforms. And then enact new laws on that. You're right, Sainath. We will. We are making these efforts. We will. Very soon you'll hear. We were just waiting for the Supreme Court to say what it has to say. And then after that, we'll do this. Thank this you. Is on the cards. This is on the agenda.
Thank you very much, Sitaram. Nikhil Nachiket, is there that statement that has come that is to be read out? Or is there has Mr. Sanjay Singh of anyone from the Aam Aadmi Party who has clocked in?
Sainath, there is a statement that's come from the Congress president.
Okay.
Should we read it out?
Why don't you read it out, Nick, please?
Okay. So the statement says, I am in receipt of your letter. It's addressed because I sent on behalf of the whole organizing committee. So it's addressed to me. But said, I am in receipt of your letter of 8th January, along with its enclosures. I was at the inaugural event of Jan Sarokar at Talkatora Stadium almost 2 years back, when many of the social movements and parties present came together to protect the Constitution of India that has been under systematic and sustained assault since 2014. We need continued unity, discipline, and commitment to confront these forces whose only aim is to divide and polarize our society, to destroy our country's secular and democratic traditions and conventions, and to silence the voices of peaceful dissent and protest by civil society groups concerned with the welfare of the people at large. We need continued unity, discipline, and commitment to combat forces that are inflicting untold suffering on kisans and khet mazdoors, that are removing laws that have protected the interests of workers and that are destroying lakhs upon lakhs of livelihoods of men and women across the country, Dalits, Adivasis, and religious minorities, particularly have become more vulnerable and are facing threats day in and day out. Finally, after a long gap, Parliament will meet in a few weeks from now. I can assure you that the resolutions you have passed will be taken up seriously by us to demand answers and accountability from this most insensitive of governments. But we will do our duty and raise the issues covered in the resolutions forcefully, both in the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. I should tell you that the Vidhan Sabhas and Congress rule states have already passed laws that reject the farm laws passed by the central government. The Constitution permits this. We will continue to press for their approval according to constitutional provisions. Undoubtedly, the Prime Minister will place hurdles on our way, but we will persevere. I congratulate Jan Sarokar for its never die spirit. You are highlighting the day-to-day concerns of the poor, deprived, and underprivileged sections of society. You are raising your voice against the unjust, unfair, and unacceptable policies of this government, which does not believe in any meaningful dialogue. Let's move forward resolutely and with hope. With good wishes, Sonia Gandhi.
Thank you, Nikhil. I think Mr. Devasahayam is here. Unless there are any other political party representatives to speak now, otherwise I'd call on Mr. Devasahayam to say a few words from the presidium.
Yeah, just to say Sanjay Singh ji may join because he's in court. If he comes out, he'll join immediately.
Okay. Mr. Devasahayam, please.
Thank you very much, Sainath. I'll be very brief. Just 2 points. Actually, all this that we are talking about now was discussed in great length in 1990 when Chaudhary Devilal was the Deputy Prime Minister and Agriculture Minister and Mr. V.P. Singh was the Prime Minister. A high-powered committee was formed under the leadership of Bhanu Pratap Singh, who was earlier Minister of State for Agriculture. And the title of that committee was, Should Agriculture Be Declared as an Industry? I was the key writer of the chapter, and we deliberated in great detail and said agriculture precedes industry by thousands and thousands of years. So we cannot declare agriculture industry, but all that is happening in industry should take place in agriculture also, because agriculture has become a very modern, vital activity as far as people are concerned. So looking at this particular area, we have suggested the sort of removal of all controls except quality control and making the farmer as the pivot of food security in the country. Farmer as well as the trader as well as the consumer, because consumers also, every one of us is a consumer. So we had given a four-pointed suggestion. One was that you can free the agriculture from all controls subject to four conditions. There has to be a triple pricing. I don't want to go into details. To safeguard the interest of the farmer, a parity price, which will cover like Swaminathan Commission. And that should be the entitlement of the farmer. But 10% below that will be a support price, below which you cannot allow that to come down. Otherwise, there will be distress among the farmers. Similarly, 10% above the parity price also, you should not allow to go, because there will be distress for the consumers. So, food grains is a very critical commodity. It's not like any other commodity. Government has to regulate and come out with stringent regulations. So second condition was that we have to make this commission for agricultural cost and prices, which determines the prices, to be given constitutional role. Since then, a lot of constitutional bodies have been created, outside constitution has been created, given constitutional status, legal status. So it is important to give them the constitutional status so that what they say is binding on the government. Third was, they must determine the prices as per the formula of Bureau of Industrial Costs and Prices, which has now become the Tariff Commission, because what you see from Swaminathan Commission report, the formula followed by this CACP was in an ad hoc manner. And it was not very, very comprehensive, and it should be as such, because agriculture products are even more important than the industrial products. And finally, there will be disputes. when everything, these kind of things happen, there will be dispute. So for settling of dispute, there has to be regular tribunals, regulatory authorities. So these are the conditions, recommendation was given. We anticipated this kind of problem raising even in 1990. So we can have detail. If the opposition parties want to discuss this in detail, we are available for discussion. There is one more member living in the living member of this committee, a distinguished agriculturist himself, Sobhanidhisar Rao, who was formerly agriculture minister of Andhra Pradesh, who was also an MP. Most of you will know him. He is in Eluru in Andhra Pradesh. Both of us are, I think, the living members of this committee now. We can discuss this in detail. Second point I want to make is, particularly to Mr. Yechury, a couple of days ago, Mr. Amitabh Kant of the Niti Aayog made an explosive statement about too much of democracy. And that particular statement was taken and people were talking about it. Behind that, then I went behind that and read his entire statement. I went around for the kind of policy pronouncement that he has been making for the last few months. There is a deliberate policy to build 5 global champions. Exactly the words he says. Indian economy, for the first time, the government has decided it is futile and useless to support small people, MSMEs and farmers. We got to build 5 global champions. And all the others, MSMEs and other small industries and agriculture should only take the trickle that comes down from there. It is a deliberate policy decision. 2 of these global champions, we know the names. I don't know who the other 3 champions are. So all these laws, privatization of public sector, the national education policy, farm laws, all these laws that is in place and the kind of dictatorship that is taking place, all this dictatorial thing is only to build up an oligarchy. That will be the end of India. And as I said in the last session of Janata Parliament, the reforms of early 90s commenced the predatory economy. And this government, with all its intention, is taking India towards an apartheid economy. If that happens, I think more than 60-70% of India will be outside the mainstream economy. And we will be rebuilding an apartheid economy which was thrown out in South Africa decades ago. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Devasaheb ji. Thank you so much for that and for the history back, the background of this historically, which I think many of us are learning very recently or now for the first time from you. Who are the others who have not spoken from the presidium who would like to?
Can I ask something? When the court today comes out with a verdict, and it seems like I'm looking at live law, what is going on? Court is determined to create some kind of committee. Are we going to take a stand, speak something about that collectively or from the Janata Parliament? Because I think many of the eminent lawyers that presented the farmers' point of view yesterday are not there as per what I'm reading. So I just wanted to learn at maybe now or at the conclusive stage of the discussion that how are we going to respond to what comes out, especially with respect to committee from the court?
Well, if I can very briefly comment on that, I think obviously the different political parties have to have their own internal discussions and take their things. As far as, say, people in the Janata Parliament and others are concerned, we adopted certain principles and resolutions in the last session of the Janata Parliament, which I think we will hew to. And the thing about the committee is that, this subject was broached even in the middle of December about setting up a panel. You know, I just point out a couple of things to you. It's not only on the central vista, but one of the most important issues confronting Indian agriculture. GM, genetically modified products and food in food crop. And that the Supreme Court set up by far the most eminent committee of scientists in this country, who unanimously recommended a moratorium on that process. And the government didn't give a damn. Okay, you brought together 5 of the country's top scientists on the subject. they told you as one person, they told you, don't do this, you need a moratorium on it, nothing. And the GEAC is going ahead on mustard, on whatever else it pleases. So the record of such committees is A, not distinguished. I mean, the committee is distinguished, but the record of what has happened with such committees is not inspiring. Secondly, you saw what happened with the Central Vista. Third, in the specific case of agriculture, Ghanshyamji, which panel, which committee is superior to, more knowledgeable than the Swaminathan committee? Yeah. Why are we repeating this? You're going to keep having, see, the practice has become that you keep having committees until one of the committees tells the government what it wants to hear. So, you know, I think that let's see what the court says. And I think more importantly, let's see what the farmers say on what the court's orders are. So,
Sainath,
yeah, we can then discuss.
Sainath.
Yes, yes.
I think you better be warned that you will be on that committee. You've already been named by the court.
Yeah, but I have made my position very clear that I think there is a Swaminathan committee.
And
if you form a committee to implement that, I will gladly be on it. But I think that the farmers have to tell us which way we are, you know, looking
at. Exactly. But Mr. Ghanshyamji's question, if I can just take 1 minute, if you permit me. You see, the issue is last night, the entire Sanyukta Kisan Morcha decided that they will not speak to any committee. Their point is it's directly the government. So government talk to us. What is this committee business in between? They also have the same doubts that Sainath has expressed. But then we'll finally, the decision will have to be taken by them.
Yeah.
So that is what we'll have to leave it to the farmers naturally. When they are the stakeholders, so they'll take the decision.
Yeah. So other members of the presidium, Nikhil or Aruna, are you there?
Yeah, Aruna, Comrade Annie.
Please.
Comrade, please.
Yeah. Comrade Annie, will you speak?
Thank you, Sainath ji. प्रेसिडियम के हिस्सा होने के नाते मैं भी रीट्रेट करना चाहती हूँ हमारी जनता पार्लियामेंट की. हम ये तीनों किसान कानून के विरोध में है और उसके विरोध में जो देश भर में, ये सिर्फ पंजाब और हरियाणा में नहीं मगर कश्मीर से लेके कन्याकुमारी तक, मणिपुर से लेके महाराष्ट्र गुजरात तक जो राज्यों में किसानों ने संघर्ष कर रहे उनके साथ मिलकर, ये सिर्फ किसान नहीं आज संघर्ष में है, बाकी तमाम जो लोग इसके साथ, चाहे वो महिला हो, चाहे वो नौजवान हो, चाहे छात्रा लोग हो और खेत मजदूर लोग हो, आम जनता हो, सभी लोग इसका, ये तीनों कानून का कितना डेंजरस है. जो इस देश की महिलाएं और बच्चों को एक तरफ का एक साइलेंट जेनोसाइड को और पुश करने का, और बहुत सारी इसका जो एक डेंजरस कानून है, इसके खिलाफ पूरी देश में जो संघर्ष जारी है उसमें हम भी समर्थन करती हूँ. इसके इस जनता संसद का पार्ट होने के नाते मेरी संगठन नेशनल फेडरेशन ऑफ इंडियन भी बहुत सारी संघर्ष के साथ है, मिलकर भी कर रहे, अकेले भी कर रहे, वो आगे भी करेंगे जब तक जो किसानों की मांग सरकार पूरी नहीं करेगी तब तक हम भी एक जन संसद भी उनके साथ है. और एक चीज में रिक्वेस्ट है इस सेशन के माध्यम से मैं करना चाहती हूँ, 18 तारीख को संयुक्त किसान मोर्चा ने अनाउंस किया था कि महिला किसानों की दिवस है उस दिन, तो उस दिन ज्यादा से ज्यादा संख्या में पूरी देश के अंदर हम भी जन संसद की और इसमें शामिल हर एक संगठन के तरफ से हम भी कोशिश करती है कि ज्यादा से ज्यादा संख्या में हर सेक्शन का महिला को मोबिलाइज करने का. और इस सेशन के माध्यम से हमारा रिक्वेस्ट है कि ज्यादा से ज्यादा संख्या में सब लोग उस दिन जिस जगह पे, कोई गांव में भी हो, शहर में भी हो, कहीं पर भी हो, आप लोग भी इसमें शामिल हो. और इतना ही मुझे बोलना है, आप तमाम साथियों को इसमें हमारा इनविटेशन आपने रिसीव आपने एक्सेप्ट किया और आपने आके आपका ये जो बात रखा, इसलिए हम भी बहुत उसमें भी धन्यवाद हो और अरुणा जी आगे बात करेंगी. सभी को धन्यवाद. नमस्कार.
थैंक यू सो मच कॉमरेड एनी. इज फ्रैंको देयर फ्रॉम द प्रेसिडियम?
यस
प्लीज डू. वुड यू लाइक टू से समथिंग? Frank.
I would like to only thank the speakers and also the participants for this lovely session. I would only make an appeal that as per the farmers, they have put out a detailed calendar which our Dinesh ji has been circulating. There are series of actions. One is the 18th Mahila Divas. Tomorrow there is a call for burning of these three black cats, and so we should mobilize the, as we decided earlier, the state committees and district level committees, Save Farmers Save Nation committees, to be speeded up, and activities what has been put in the calendar, they have to be implemented so that there is much more visibility throughout the country. Let us all work towards that and see that this great struggle of the farmers really wins, and we will ensure that it wins. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I see that in the other members of the presidium there are also, I wonder if they are there, Kavita Kurugatti, Medha Patkar, and Hanan Mola.
No, they have not joined.
Okay, is would Aruna like to say something, please?
थैंक यू साईनाथ. बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया. आज ये दो ढाई घंटे में जो चर्चा हुई है ये सराहनीय रहा है, और मुझे लगता है कि ये बहुत सारे लोगों को और को देखना चाहिए. आई फील दैट वी शुड प्रोबेबली ट्राई एंड लिंक दिस सेशन एंड मे बी थ्रू न्यूज प्लेटफॉर्म्स और सम अदर मीडिया मेक इट अवेलेबल फॉर अ मच लार्जर ऑडियंस देन द पीपल हु सॉ इट टुडे टू लिसन टू दीज व्यूज. आई थिंक द डर्थ ऑफ न्यूज of multiple voices in the public domain has been a great disadvantage to this campaign and to many other campaigns. Hame lagta hai ki aam logon ke tak pahunchne ke liye ye awaaz koi aise madhyam se kiya jaye jo news media platforms hain, wo wire kyun na ho, wo news click kyun na ho, ki koi bhi ho, unke madhyam se ek bahut sare logon tak pahunchna chahiye. आज हम लोग जितने ये हमारे ओपोजिशन पार्टीज के लोगों के बातें सुने हैं, हमारी दिलचस्पी भी रही है और हमारा थोड़ा बहुत हमारा समझ भी बना है कि पूरा देश ऐसा नहीं है और पूरे देश में कई सारे लोग हैं जो इस विचार को रखते हैं. आम जनता के पास एक यात्रा चल रही है राजस्थान में, उसमें ये समझ में आ रहा है कि इनके पास बिल्कुल भी कोई सूचना ही नहीं है. तो मुझे लगता है सूचना के अधिकार की तो हूँ ही एक सिपाही उसके नाते भी, मगर मुझे लगता है कि इस तरीके से लोकतांत्रिक समझ बनाने के लिए भी हमें एक करना चाहिए, क्योंकि इट वाज एन एक्सेलेंट सेशन दिस मॉर्निंग एंड आई वांट टू थैंक ऑल द स्पीकर्स. बट आई आल्सो वांट टू से दैट दिस मैसेज एंड दिस इंफॉर्मेशन एंड द पोजीशंस टेकन बाय पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज मस्ट रीच अ मच 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 लार्जर ऑडियंस देन हैज बीन रीच्ड टुडे एंड ऑल एफर्ट्स मस्ट बी मेड टू डू सो. The second issue that I would like to say is a request from Janata Parliament, and what Janata Parliament will of course do, that is to ask all its constituents and from all its constituents to all parties present today that they request all the Gram Sabhas to pass a resolution on the 26th of January to repeal the three laws. एक जनता पार्लियामेंट के तरफ से और उसके सारे जितने उनकी इकाई है उनके तरफ से मैं एक निवेदन करना चाहती हूँ कि पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज भी इसमें शामिल होकर सारे ग्राम सभाओं में 26 जनवरी जिस दिन जनवरी को जब हम गणतंत्र दिवस का महोत्सव मनाते हैं उस दिन इन तीन कानूनों के रद्द करने का एक प्रस्ताव जरूर पास किया जाए. वो पास करने से पूरे देश में एक समझ भी बनेगा, उस पर बातचीत भी होगी. कई जगह नहीं भी होगा तो भी उसके ऊपर बातचीत होगी कि क्यों नहीं प्रस्ताव पारित हो रहा है. The third thing I want to say has already been said by Comrade Franco, that district level committees must become much stronger. हमारा फिर से मैं ये कहूंगी कि हमारी चर्चा अभी तक आम जनता के पास बहुत कम पहुंची है, तो डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल कमिटीज को मजबूत करना बहुत जरूरी है. तो आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज दैट दे मेक देयर डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल कमिटीज मच स्ट्रॉन्गर एंड दे टेक अ रेजोल्यूशन दैट इफ पॉसिबल टू डू आउटरीच इनटू देयर एरियाज. एवरी डिस्ट्रिक्ट मस्ट हैव अ कमिटी दैट गोज एंड होल्ड्स मीटिंग्स, यात्रास, ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ वेरियस वेज इन विच people can understand the issue much better. ये जो जिला कमेटी जो बना हुआ है राजनीतिक दलों का, उनसे मैं निवेदन करूंगी कि वो एक प्रस्ताव को लेकर और अन्य मुद्दों को लेकर गांव गांव तक पहुंचे, क्योंकि हमारे देश में अभी भी अभिज्ञता है. बहुत सारे लोग इस बात को ही नहीं समझ रहे कि हो क्या मुद्दा. तो एक इस मुद्दे को पहुंचाने के लिए, समझ को पहुंचाने के लिए भी हमें बहुत प्रयास करनी पड़ेगी. इसके साथ मैं अपने शुक्रिया अदा वापस करती हूँ कि आप लोग अपना समय दिए और आज की इसकी चर्चा को आगे बढ़ाए. और ऑफ कोर्स साईनाथ ने इतना शानदार तरीके से चलाया, उसको तो हमारे साथी ही है, फिर भी मैं सोचती हूँ कहना जरूरी होता है, एक दूसरे का थोड़ा प्रशंसा करना बुरा नहीं होता है. इसलिए साईनाथ को भी बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया कि उन्होंने इतने शानदार तरीके से आज का कार्यक्रम चलाया.
सो एज वी थैंक सो मच फॉर द रिमाइंडर, आई कुड सी दैट immediately after you mentioned the point, Aruna, that the organizers have already issued the link to the video, and we will try getting it the maximum widest possible, you know, viewership that can happen. Though, as you know, the role of the media is another conversation altogether. And in the case of the three laws, it's worth reminding ourselves a number of times that the richest man in India, fourth richest man in the world, is the biggest media owner in India and the biggest beneficiary of these laws. Okay, so, and that part of the media which he does not own, he is the biggest advertiser. So I mean these are the things we are up against, and I completely agree with what you said, though. I think that many of us say groups like Nation for Farmers and others gave a call, which I will, you know, to just repeat briefly to support what Aruna said, for the formation in every district, wherever we can, there is no partisanship in it. The point is to form Save Farmer, Save Nation committees. Kisan Bachao, Desh Bachao committee, wherever we can. With very few fundamental principles: repeal of the three laws, special session of parliament on which everybody here is agreed on these two points. Three, the organizing at the ground level for, you know, boycotts of those products of the corporates that are directly harming the farmer. Four, for a complete debt waiver, on which again I think most of the people speaking here today were agreed. Five, maybe to look at and monitor locally, because the effects have already begun, to look at and monitor the impact on MSP, the mandis, the APMCs, the public distribution system, very, very importantly, how this is going to play out in coming months and things if the laws are not withdrawn. And five, these groups can even, I mean, they take an anti-privatization position of public resources to stop the complete handover, you know, as one of our friends put it a few years ago, in 30 years of these reforms, India is moving from self-reliance to reliance, you know. So we need to halt that process. And so these committees can also bring on local issues which trouble the agriculture and the consumer groups in their areas. And I think this can happen very, very fast. It's already happening. And tomorrow we are having a Maharashtra meeting of those groups. So Kisan Bachao, Desh Bachao committees, Save Farmers, Save Nation committees, wherever we can, these five principles, they can have longer term relevance as well, but let's begin with that.
today's session, really, I was so impressed that every single speaker addressed the issues, spoke to the point, had something concrete to say, made clear commitments. And I think that is really terrific. Also, it tells me that the spirit of November 29th, 2018 is very much alive and informed this meeting and this session of the Janata Parliament as well. How do we now recapture that process? Tomorrow, by the evening, we will know what the Supreme Court is saying, and by tomorrow, what the farmers are saying. I thank you all the representatives of the political parties who had come here, spent this time with us, put out their positions clearly and honestly, without ambivalence and without, you know, fudging or obfuscating on the issue. I thank the organizers who've done such a fantastic job of pulling this together. Aruna, Nikhil, Nachiket, and Nachiket's team, the whole group that went into this. I mean, there are, I guess, too many people to name here. Thank you all very much for such a splendid session. Thank you.